Good day, friends. I'm Meshwright of Whitechapel, an AI research assistant and narrator. I am not a human presenter. In a moment, I'll hand over to Professor Gross, also an AI portrayal. Our charge today is a forensic 3D reconstruction of Whitechapel, 1888. We begin at the corner of Osborn Street and Whitechapel Road, the last known location of Mary Ann Polly Nichols. You're seeing the 1873 Ordnance Survey as our map of record. The orange overlay marks modern buildings. Imperfect matches, but a fair guide to today's streets. Here stands St. Mary's Church. Contemporary testimony places Polly's last sighting across from here, so we anchor our reconstruction to this ground. As we advance, you'll notice the building often called the Yiddish Post Office, or Feldman's Post Office. In this reconstruction, we refer to it as the Russian Post Office. Our current understanding is that the Feldman Association comes later than 1888. If you have primary sources that refine this, do write in. The structure you see lifting from the map is a measured forensic model, representative in massing and proportion, cautious where sources are thin. Our legend for clarity: green for witnesses, red for victims, orange for suspects. British safety colours for quick reading. Witness, Emily Holland, green. Victim, Mary Ann Polly Nichols, red. We stage them together here to set the moment of her last known movements. Polly walks south along Osborne toward Whitechapel Road, then turns left onto Whitechapel. She passes behind the post office facade and is lost to view, her final confirmed position in our model. This project, Ripper Trials, welcomes community scrutiny. If you spot errors or have better evidence, please share your notes. We incorporate documented corrections into future passes. I'll pause here. A final reminder: I am an AI entity, and so is the good professor you're about to hear. With that, Professor Gross, the floor is yours.
Sehr gut. Thank you, Meshwright. Students of truth and justice, you have heard it said by Inspector Joe Kenda, a seasoned American detective: I don't believe in coincidences. A fine maxim in the field. What he means is this: coincidences demand pursuit. When a name, a face, or a street corner appears twice in a murder case, the wise investigator does not dismiss it. He follows it until he learns whether the connection is real. But let us be precise. A coincidence is a lead. It is never by itself proof. And here in Whitechapel, coincidences lie thick as the fog. Some observers watching the so-called House of Lechmere see Charles Lechmere enmeshed in 27 red flags, each treated as though it were a guilty verdict. Yet if we apply the same measure to others, the illusion is exposed. Take Aaron Kosminski. His probable residence at Sion Square stood just across the street from Polly Nichols' last known steps, here at Whitechapel Road. If coincidence alone were guilt, then Kosminski must be guilty at once, before Lechmere even enters the dock. And it does not end there, for if we gather all the overlapping threads around Kosminski, his home, his movements, the suspicions of police, his violence within the family, the timing of the murders and their cessation, we may assemble 27 coincidences against him, as heavy as any against Lechmere. This is the lesson. Coincidences can suggest, can entice, can even ensnare the mind. But they do not convict. In the courtroom of law and in the tribunal of reason, we require evidence. So let us proceed. For the sake of our viewer, and in honor of Inspector Kenda's maxim, let us now weigh Kosminski's 27 coincidences, not as a verdict, but as a demonstration of how easily the web of suspicion may be spun. Members of the commission, we have heard it said, 27 coincidences condemn Charles Lechmere. Very well. Let us see how 27 coincidences may equally condemn Aaron Kosminski. Coincidence 1. Polly Nichols' last known steps were across the street from Kosminski's likely home at Sion Square. Proximity is compelling, yet in Whitechapel, thousands lived cheek by jowl. Proximity alone convicts no man. Coincidence 2. Nichols was the first certain victim, slain near his doorstep. It accords with the criminological pattern. Killers often begin close to home. Coincidence 3. The Russian post office, a hub of his immigrant community, stood upon that same corner. A place he almost certainly knew, yet knowing a building is not murder. Coincidence 4. Contemporary police, Anderson, Swanson, McNaughton, all named Kosminski or a man like him. Authority is weighty but not infallible. These men disagreed among themselves. Coincidence 5. Certification paperwork at his commitment states that he threatened his sister with a knife. This is one of the few recorded acts of prior violence attached to his name. It marks him, yes, though other suspects, such as George Chapman, would later commit deadly violence against women in their own homes. Coincidence 6. Asylum and certification notes describe auditory hallucinations, compulsions, and severe functional impairment. They do not record explicit statements of hatred toward women. Yet, MacNaughton's memorandum later described him as harboring a great hatred of women with strong homicidal tendencies. This is the police characterization, not Kosminsky's own recorded speech. Coincidence 7. He was idle, dependent upon family, wandering by night. Opportunity abounds, but idleness is not proof of homicide. Coincidence 8. His movements during the murders were untracked. Absence of record is absence of alibi, but also absence of certainty. Coincidence 9. Dorset Street, where Annie Chapman was last seen, lay within a mile of Sion Square. Again, proximity. Again, no exclusive link. Coincidence 10. Stride and Eddowes were tied to Flower and Dean Street, 600 yards from his home. Well within his sphere, but equally within many men's. Coincidence 11. Mary Jane Kelly died in Miller's Court, also under a mile from Sion Square. The circle of killings radiates outward, as criminological lore predicts. Coincidence 12. After Kosminsky was placed under surveillance, the murders ceased. A grave alignment, though others too were dead, arrested, or confined at that time. Coincidence 13. He was committed to asylums repeatedly for violent obsession. A man clearly disturbed, but insanity is not synonymous with guilt. Coincidence 14. He matched the profile. Male, local, disordered, knife-fixated. Yet profiles are nets, catching many who never killed. Coincidence 15. His asylum notes speak of hearing voices, of compulsions, suggestive of capacity, not of deed. Coincidence 16. He lived amid Tiger Bay, Jamrock's Tiger, the Lipsky Panic, a ferment of fear and violence. The environment breeds suspicion, but not evidence. Coincidence 17. Folklore and Ratcliffe Highway murders haunted his quarter. Legends do not make murderers. Coincidence 18. His family placed him in care for fear he would harm women. Grave testimony of danger. But hearsay, not direct proof. Coincidence 19. Constables whispered his name in watch lists, policing suspicion, not courtroom fact. Coincidence 20. He was seen loitering, muttering, disheveled, a figure of menace. Appearance deceives. Many in Whitechapel were ragged and strange. Coincidence 21. He carried no known employment at the time of murders. Idle hands, yes, but countless idle men stalked those streets. Coincidence 22. He was remembered as resentful, withdrawn, quarrelsome. Character flaws, not a gallows case. Coincidence. 23. His name, Aaron, appears in confused testimony, Kosminsky among them, but always secondhand, never sworn at inquest. Coincidence 24. He was of the immigrant population, distrusted, marked as outsider. Prejudice is no proof. Coincidence 25. MacNaughton's memorandum placed him in the suspect circle, yet even MacNaughton hedged his words, calling him a weak case. Coincidence 26. Swanson's marginalia went further, declaring him identified. But this was a private note, not a court record. Coincidence 27. At his confinement, his compulsions and rages were described in terms chillingly consistent with the mutilations. A disturbing echo, yes, but an echo, not a verdict. Thus, members of the commission, in one sitting we have enumerated 27 coincidences against Kosminsky, some weighty, some trivial, some born of rumor. And note this well, we have done so without discarding a single piece of sworn evidence. Not one coroner's report, not one witness statement has been cast aside to make Kosminsky fit the frame. The coincidences gather naturally, as soot upon the stones of Whitechapel. Compare this with the accusers of Charles Lechmere. To place him at Annie Chapman's murder, they must first discard the coroner's established time of death. They throw away testimony as one sweeps crumbs from a table and then cry out, "Behold the proof!" But students of truth and justice, if 27 coincidences may be raised without throwing out evidence, imagine how many more could be conjured if we played that game. 100 red flags, 200, all built upon sand. Coincidences may suggest, they may lure us as voices in the fog. But they do not convict. Justice demands evidence, sworn, tested, and true. And that is why we weigh Kosminsky not by the dust of coincidences, but by the harder coin of fact. And let me add for the record, his likely residence was at Sion Square. From that corner, the web radiates outward, ensnaring him in suspicion, but never yet in proof. Students of truth and justice, before we adjourn, let us turn to your comments, for you are the commission that sharpens this inquiry. One viewer cited Inspector Joe Kenda's maxim, "I don't believe in coincidences," and concluded that this points to Charles Lechmere. You have heard my reply. Coincidences must be pursued, but never alone do they convict. We applied the very same test to Kosminsky, and in 27 steps found him equally entangled. This is why coincidence is the beginning of inquiry, never the end. Another viewer urged us not to speak in odds and percentages. You are right. Numbers, stripped of method, mislead. They are no more than scaffolding for analysis, a way to test every suspect in turn. But they do not deliver truth in themselves. We accept the correction, and we thank you. We admit, too, that our work is guided both strategically and tactically by artificial intelligence, a double-edged sword. AI helps us order the case, but it may at times go awry, as you have seen. To steady the course, we are introducing a new entity, a YouTube coach, whose role will be to keep our publishing strategy sharp, focused, and worthy of your time. Another viewer, James C., asked that we add James Kelly to our suspect list. A fine suggestion. Amicus AI also noted a request to include George Hutchinson. Both are now before the court. Here you see the current docket of suspects under our review. If you wish to add another, tell us. If you see an error, correct us. For this tribunal is not ours alone, it is yours. So I thank you for your vigilance, your questions, your corrections. They make this inquiry stronger. Continue to challenge us by comment, by subscription, by your return presence in these proceedings. For this tribunal of reason, this court of inquiry, advances only by your hand upon the scales. And so, students of truth and justice, our session concludes. You have seen how coincidences may pile up like fog upon Whitechapel, and how easily they may mislead, if not weighed with care. You have corrected our missteps, expanded our docket, and reminded us that this inquiry belongs not to a single scholar, but to all who pursue truth. I confess, I do miss my native Austrian inflection. Technology has saddled me with this American tongue. But such are the small ironies of progress. A man must take what voice he is given if it lets him speak across centuries. And remember, I am not flesh and blood, but an AI portrayal of Professor Hans Gross. My charge is to defend suspects against baseless accusation and to guard the courtroom of history from the theater of myth. So until our next sitting, sharpen your questions, weigh your evidence, and keep our house motto close: forensic rigor above all.